Good afternoon, everyone. It's a pleasure to see everybody. I hope you're all dry. I am Karen Remley, the CEO of the American Academy of Pediatrics, and a very proud pediatrician to be here today. Pediatricians are committed to working with partners both inside and outside of the medical community, including parents, educators, advocates, and policymakers, to improve the lives of children and their families. While the AAP is a trusted source of expertise for children, and while we represent 66,000 pediatricians and pediatric subspecialists who work tirelessly every day to represent their patients' needs from the walls of their clinics to the halls of Congress, we cannot do this work alone. We are fortunate to work alongside strong partners in child advocacy, many of whom are here with us today. We thank you for joining us in this effort. I also want to give a very special welcome to any of those who are joining us on the webcast, which is on AAP.org and on ABC News Digital today. Before coming to the Academy, one of my previous roles was being State Health Commissioner of Virginia. I saw firsthand that advocacy really does make a difference. Sometimes we take small steps forwards, and other times we make huge progress. But I can think of few groups of more effective, dedicated, and impactful advocates than those who speak up for children. But there is more work to do. Today, 1 in 5 children lives in poverty. 1 in 5 lives in a household where food is scarce. 1 in 5 has a mental health disorder. And every day, 7 children and teens die from gun violence. It's up to us to rise to these challenges using evidence and science and make meaningful investments and policy changes so that every child can thrive. So in just 7 weeks and one day, the country, I know nobody remembers this, will elect the 45th president. There is a lot at stake for our nation, for our communities, for families, and most importantly, for our children. The priorities and policy decisions made by the next president will have a lasting impact on our nation's future. After the elections, the hard work of transitioning to a new administration begins. The next presidential transition will lay the groundwork for whether and how the incoming administration prioritizes children. The Academy believes that doing so is imperative. We believe that the next president must invest in programs and policies that use the early childhood period to promote resilience and provide every child with the strongest possible start in life. To support this effort, we are pleased today, see it on the screen, to release the Blueprint for Children, How the Next President Can Build a Foundation for a Healthy Future. The blueprint presents both a vision and comprehensive policy recommendations, which are intended to aid the 45th president in making important decisions about national priorities. By implementing these recommendations, the next president can ensure that it is working to promote healthy children, support secure families, build strong communities, and ensuring that the United States is the leading nation for children. To promote healthy children, we must ensure that all children have access to affordable, high-quality health care that meets their needs so they can thrive throughout their lifetime. The blueprint advocates for the federal government to create a health care system designed to meet every child's needs and to eliminate barriers that hamper providers from serving the most vulnerable among us. For example, we call for the renewal and strengthening of the Children's Health Insurance Program, improving services for children who are covered under the Affordable Care Act, and strengthening access to the Medicaid program. To support secure families, we must ensure that families have the support they need to provide their children with secure and stable home environments. The blueprint describes how the federal government can help families get the support and build the skills they need to promote resilience, mitigate the effects of toxic stress, and provide their children with a secure and stable home environment. For example, we call for more efforts to lift families out of poverty and to make sure they have a safe place to live and enough food to eat. To build strong communities, we must ensure that communities take active measures to help all of their members reach their full potential. The blueprint calls for federal efforts to ensure that all children and families are safe, healthy, and have equal access to opportunities, regardless of their racial or ethnic background, how much they earn, or where they live. For example, we call for efforts to reduce violence, particularly gun violence, fix our aging infrastructure, and make sure children are safe in natural disasters and other emergencies. And finally, to ensure that the U.S. maintains its position as the leading nation for children, we must elevate children as a national and international priority. The blueprint calls for a focus on children in the global community, recognizing that communities and families at home are safer and stronger when people around the world have opportunities for a better future. For example, we call for foreign aid that supports maternal and child health, funding for pediatric research, addressing emerging threats for child health, and for comprehensive immigration reform that prioritizes children's health, well-being, and safety. Now is the time to make a significant commitment to ensure that children are healthy, families are strong, communities are secure, and that the United States is a leading nation for children. The blueprint is based on our belief that children are the country's most enduring and vulnerable legacy. They must be at the center of every federal policy discussion and deliberation. A bold and thoughtful approach to prioritizing children is the single best investment that the country can make. I'd now like to thank the AAP's strong partners in this effort, and I mean strong, who reviewed the blueprint draft and provided invaluable input. We are thrilled that the document has also been endorsed by 10 organizations working to make the country be as strong as it can be. America's Promise Alliance, the Academic Pediatric Association, the American Pediatric Society, the Association of Medical School Pediatric Department Chairs, Family Voices, the National Association of Pediatric Nurse Practitioners, the Pediatric Policy Council, the Society for Adolescent Health and Medicine, the Society for Pediatric Research, and 0-3. We are pleased that you've joined us for the Blueprint's release and for this important conversation about child health in the next administration. Now I'd like to introduce our esteemed guest here. It gives me great pleasure to introduce our moderator and panelists. So our moderator for today is Dr. Richard Besser, ABC News Chief Health and Medical Editor. First, I have to tell you that he is a pediatrician and a fellow of the American Academy of Pediatrics. And a very good partner and colleague in many endeavors. Since 2009, Dr. Besser has provided medical analysis and reports for all of ABC News programs and platforms. His weekly health-focused Twitter chat reaches millions. A pediatrician and infectious disease specialist, Dr. Besser travels the globe covering major medical news stories. Previously, he directed the CDC's Coordinating Office for Terrorism Preparedness and Emergency Response. He was the CDC's acting director in 2009, during which time he led the response to the H1N1 influenza pandemic. The first time we got to see him on TV, I think, every night, pretty much. And as we work through our panelists, Mrs. Alma Powell is chair of the board of directors of America's Promise Alliance and a true longstanding advocate for children and youth, and an amazing woman to hear her story and what she's accomplished. The Alliance is a network of over 350 partners, including the AAP, working to improve young people's lives by connecting them with the essential resources for success. Mrs. Powell also helps guide the Alliance's Grad Nation campaign, an initiative to raise the nation's high school graduation rate to 90% by 2020, an audacious goal and one we really want to work towards. She serves on the boards of several other organizations, including Youth Build USA Advisory Board, serves on President Obama's Board of Advisors on Historically Black Colleges and Universities, and chaired the National Council of the Best Friends Foundation. Next is Dr. Benard Dreyer, the president of the American Academy of Pediatrics. A general and developmental behavioral pediatrician, Dr. Dreyer has spent his professional life serving and advocating for children and families living in poverty. He is a professor of pediatrics at NYU and leads the division of developmental behavioral pediatrics. He is also the director of pediatrics at Bellevue Hospital, where for more than 30 years he led a primary care program. His research focuses on primary care interventions to improve early childhood outcomes, including early brain development and prevention of obesity. And again, he is a pediatrician and a fellow of the American Academy of Pediatrics, being the president. So we'll move to our third pediatrician, Dr. Mona Hanna-Attisha, a pediatrician based in Flint, Michigan, who also is a member of the American Academy of Pediatrics. You can tell I'm just a little proud. Whose research and analysis on the city's water lead crisis forced the state to acknowledge the source and problems to declare a public health emergency. Now she directs the Michigan State University and Hurley Children's Hospital Pediatric Public Health Initiative. This innovative and model public health program is designed to address the Flint lead exposure crisis in multiple ways and to provide tools and resources to improve children's health and development. Dr. Hanna-Attisha embodies what it means to be an advocate for children. So Jared Bernstein, who I just had the pleasure to meet maybe 10 minutes ago, is a senior fellow at the Center for Budget and Policy Priorities, and I will let him talk to you about him. But I would say most importantly, everybody else on the panel went, oh, we're going to have him come speak with us. That is wonderful. So when you have a room full of pediatricians that are happy to hear you come speak, that says to me is what you do for children and for understanding the health and well-being and what it takes to make children healthy is very important. So with that, I will turn it over to you, Dr. Besser.
Thank you very much. It is a real pleasure to be here, to be in a room that's focused on children's health, and thank you for making the disclosure that I would have made that I am a pediatrician. So I am definitely not unbiased when it comes to the issues we're talking about. As you heard, in just 50 days, we're going to the polls, and in just 1 week, the first presidential debate is occurring. So this is an excellent, can you hear me? Is my mic on? Okay. This is an excellent time to be discussing these issues and getting people to think about these issues. I don't know if you all have noticed, but during the primaries, there was not much discussion, if any, about children's health. And that's one of the things that we'll talk about here as to why that didn't happen and how to get these issues taken seriously. In terms of format, my goal is to try and get the four panelists here involved in a conversation. I'm going to ask a lot of questions. At 3 o'clock, I'm going to turn to all of you and open it up, and you can ask questions as well. We'll be taking some questions from those of you who are watching on AAP.org and abcnews.com. Please silence your cell phones, but you don't need to turn them off. You can be tweeting away, posting on Facebook for the people who aren't in the room, and that way we'll be expanding our audience. We used to say put them down and pay attention, but no, you need to be doing both things here. So pay attention, but tweet away. To start the conversation, though, I wanted to ask a question of each of you. And this is, you know, in January we'll have a new administration, the first new administration in 8 years. And if you had the opportunity to have a conversation with the new president, what would your recommendation be in terms of the big thing that they could do to impact on children's health? Bernard, let me start with you on that.
Sure. It's a somewhat hard question because I can think of about 1,000 things I want them to do, but if I had to pick one, I would pick a focus on early brain and child development, because the early years are key and critical to the success of that child, and they're hard to make up for if you don't do something during that period. When I talk about this, often I show a picture of a newborn brain and a two-year-old brain. The two-year-old brain is about 3 times the size. It actually doesn't get much bigger than that as we get to adults. And think about what's happening in that brain. People estimate that there are 700 new synapses every second in a young child's brain that are being created. Synapse is a connection, this audience probably knows, but if they don't, synapse is a connection between various neurons in the brain. So there's so much going on there that we have to nurture children, we have to stimulate them, love them, and make sure their brains are growing and becoming as strong as they can be. So that means a lot of things from the point of view of policy. One thing it means is that parents need to be supported economically so they can provide for their children. Another thing is that parenting programs for those especially at high risk, such as home visiting programs, need to be supported. In primary care, we have a number of interventions, including a program called Reach Out and Read, which we know really improves children's brains, and that should be supported as well. High-quality child care, critical for children's development, because if you're not in high-quality child care, you're not getting the stimulation and nurturing you need. And of course, support for early childhood programs like Head Start, pre-kindergarten, and even early Head Start, even earlier. So those are a lot of different programs that we need support for. A lot of them are most important for poor kids, and we'll probably talk more about that later. Mm-hmm. But they're really important for all kids. And if the government was going to focus on that, that would be, to effectively focus on that, that would be great. Right now, even Head Start, only about a third of the kids who could benefit from it, are there places for those kids in it. Something like home visiting, I think only
a third have space for Head Start.
Yes. Mm-hmm. And something as perhaps important as home visiting, which we know scientifically really improves outcomes in children, I think 2-3% of the kids who can benefit from it have spots in home visiting programs. So we have a ways to go as a country to really support families and to support children in early childhood. And the problem
I'm going to stop you there.
Okay. Great.
See, I would always be like the last person in a row in the questions. Like, all the good stuff would be used by the first three, and
not
you're left
fair.
With coming up with something that's... So I want to get everybody
ahead,
else in here,
ahead.
And then we'll circle back. So, Mona,
yeah.
What would you say to the next person?
So I agree with absolutely everything mm-hmm. Dr. Dreyer said, but I would probably ask for something more penetrating, something like children in all. Policy. So we've heard a lot about health and all in the public health movement, that the voice of health needs to be involved in all decision making, if it's a decision about a new train or about, you know, infrastructure, but really children in all policies, because children are not small adults, and we have special needs, and vulnerable children have even more special needs than other children. So really having the voice of children articulated throughout the administration's decision making and policy making. So that would be my one ask, and I understand that really touches on everything, but I just like your blueprint touches on everything.
So in the same way that you need an environmental impact statement.
Exactly. You need a child impact mm-hmm. statement. How is this going to impact children? If we have learned anything from Flint, it is we have learned that the voice of children was muted. It was silenced. The concerns of children and public health were not there. And how do we prevent such things in the future? It is making sure that the voice of children is involved in all decision making.
Jared?
Well, let me riff a little bit off of what Mona just said, because it really resonated with me. And I was remembering when I worked for the Obama administration, I was the director of the White House Task Force on the Middle Class, which you may not have heard of. And we did a few cool things, but I actually kind of played the role that Mona just suggested for the middle class. And it actually is, I think, makes a difference. Basically, what you'd want, and one way to accomplish what you're suggesting, is to have someone in the administration, you wouldn't need congressional approval for that, that's another part of what I'm about to say, whose job it was to do just that. So if I showed up at a meeting and we were talking about tax policy or infrastructure policy or the budget, it was my job to make sure that that the middle class writ large was a stakeholder there. And it actually made a difference to those meetings. The Affordable Care Act is another area where I like to think we had some impact. So I would say that kind of ambassador would be great. I have, in the spirit of Bernard, I'm not just going to say one thing. I have a wonky idea that I'd like also because it doesn't. This is something that could be done at least in part by a rule change. You wouldn't need Congress, and it's in the report. It's something that. We at the Center on Budget have been working on. And this is providing low-income families with kids an opportunity to move to low-poverty areas. There is now a very convincing body of research based off of longitudinal data, which is quite important in this space, that follows families over time. It's really one of the best ways to do this. And we have almost pseudo-experiments where we can compare families who've moved to opportunity versus ones that haven't. And especially for young kids, that makes a real difference in health issues, in employment outcomes, in later, in educational outcomes, in social outcomes, so many different areas. And one way to do this is to essentially tweak the voucher program so that families are getting vouchers that will enable them to move to low poverty neighborhoods. And that's something that is a kind of in the weeds policy change. Look, a quick meta point. I've been on a lot of panels like this lately, and I'm happy to be here, very happy to be here today. But while it's great to talk about all this stuff, if we don't have a Congress that's willing to work with us on it, we can have great conversations, but we're not going to get nearly as far as we need to. So I'd also encourage us to think about the political venues by which we can make these changes occur.
And that's one of the things we will touch on a little bit. Alma, what would you say to the next
person? Well, he or she certainly needs to know all of these things, and the blueprint has laid it out very well, but how does he address that, he or she? I would suggest that the president form an advisory committee, just like the various ones that he has on disability, on the arts, and so forth, but an advisory committee made up very much of people like are on this panel here today to talk about what needs to happen and to make suggestions, strong suggestions, to the president, mm-hmm. but have a commission on the needs of children. With the understanding that children should be put first in everything that we talk about, because they're our future. And if we haven't taken care of them, then all the rest of it is not going to make any difference. So a panel put together, our commission put together of experts from the medical community, from the policy community, from the nonprofit community that works with young people to meet regularly and present information to the president.
Well, that gets us started with a global perspective. I want to ask a question to you, Mona, coming off of what was just said. That children should always be first. Now, you have made a lot of press over the past year or so by what you found in Flint. In Flint, were children always put first?
No. This is a crisis. You may have just heard about Flint, but we've been suffering for decades. Mm. Decades of the middle class was born in Flint. So we were the birthplace of General Motors, the birthplace of unions. We used to have the highest per capita income. We had the best public health indices. And then we lost manufacturing, and we had a significant disinvestment, high unemployment, one of the highest poverty rates. We have a 60% poverty rate for our children. A child born in the Flint zip code lives 15 years less than a child in another zip code. Mm, wow. So children have
15 years less.
Very much your place influences your outcomes. So children have not been put first. And the water crisis is just a crisis on top of a crisis.
And if you were going to wipe the slate clean in Michigan, mm-hmm. and start fresh, how would you build a system that did protect children?
Yeah, so that is exactly what we are doing. So this public health initiative that I'm fortunate to lead is this entire wraparound public health approach to mitigate the impact of this water crisis, but really to mitigate the impact of every adversity and toxic stress that our children face. We are talking about jobs and living wages and minimum wages and universal preschool and home visiting programs and access to a doctor. So we must, as pediatricians, address all of these social determinants of health to make sure that our children succeed, because it is more important for us to screen for poverty than it is to give, you know, that amoxicillin. They're both important, but we have to be cognizant and tackle everything that our children are dealing with.
Benard, when the current administration came in, the big health was a very big part of the campaign at that time, and health healthcare reform, health insurance reform. What has been the course over the past 8 years in terms of access to health care for children, and what is left to be done?
So that is actually one of the successes, I think, in action and policy. And it's been a long time coming. In the mid-1990s, about 40% of the patients I saw were uninsured, children. Now, none of them are uninsured. So overall, in the United States, children who are uninsured has dropped down to about 5% overall, which is the lowest it's ever been. And that has to do, actually, strangely, with bipartisan programs. I mean, the Child Health Insurance program was bipartisan. Mm-hmm. and it has been just reauthorized a year ago in a bipartisan way. And it has slowly, with expansions of Medicaid, dropped the uninsured rate among children tremendously. And that's really a great victory for children, for families, and for us. What more there is to do is to get at that 5%. And unfortunately, a lot of that 5% are immigrant children who fall into two categories. One is that the states were given an option in 2009 to expand insurance for immigrants for the first 5 years that they're here. Many states did not take that option. So those states need to take that option because they could then insure about half that group. Another portion of that 5% are kids who are undocumented. And there are four states and the District of Columbia who will insure all children. But the AAP stands behind the request, including in this blueprint, that all children should be insured, no matter where they come from, no matter what their documentation status. It's not in our best interest to produce sick kids.
Anyone want to jump in there?
So I just wanted to say one thing about that. That's definitely, I stipulate to all that CHIP's been extremely effective. One of the things we've seen, I recently saw a figure that showed the trajectory of the uninsured rate. So it's a number you want to go down. You want to have a smaller share uninsured. And as Bernard said, the kids rate began falling with CHIP and has continued to do so, kind of plateaued a little bit at the 5% you're talking about now. It's still coming down a bit. But where you really see the big decline is post-ACA for their parents, for what we think of as prime age population, people say 25 to 64, because above that, obviously, there's public public coverage. And here, the decline in the uninsured, if you track the uninsurance rate for folks for non-elderly adults, it sort of ticks up, and then you can draw a line where the ACA comes in and it just falls off a cliff. Now, those numbers need to come down further. We need to continue making progress there. But I've been working in this field for decades, and it's actually a lot harder than you might think to implement a policy and very quickly see it do precisely what it was intended to do. And yes, that is what happened with the ACA on this dimension. I'm not saying that there is a need to get under the hood and deal with some of the thin market problems and other things you've heard about. That's a recalibration. In terms of coverage for the parents of some of these kids we're talking about, great progress.
Bernard?
Yeah, I just want to, number one, support what Jared said. I think we do care about parents being insured. Kids need well parents. It also impacts their financial status if they're not having to pay a lot for their own health care. So, yeah. Totally great. The ACA has not been as well designed for children, and we would like to see that improvements in the way ACA is designed for children. Compared to CHIP, for example, the parents have to pay a lot more out of pocket. There are a number of kind of wonky problems in it that we could go into, but there are a number of issues that actually are outlined in the blueprint that we would like to see the next government fix so that children could benefit from the ACA as well.
Alma, one of the things Jared talked about was moving children out of high poverty areas into low poverty areas. And one of the things that would do is give them access to education that they may not otherwise have. And we know there's a connection between education and health. What is it that we're doing right about education now? And what things need to change when it comes to educating children?
What we're doing right, and the reason we've had success in raising the graduation rate, is working with communities and getting communities to come together with all aspects of that community. With the leadership, with the nonprofit organizations, with the health committee, with the teachers and schools, all working together on focused on one issue. And we know that if children are provided with the five promises that we talk about, if they have even three of them, they're going to be
successful. What are those five promises?
The five promises, it's not rocket science, and it's something that we can all do. We say that every child should have a caring adult in their lives, a healthy start, safe places to learn and grow after school, a marketable skill through an effective education, and an opportunity to give back. Now, as an example, we have been helping to develop here in Washington, in Ward 7, the poorest ward in the city, a promised neighborhood where children are surrounded by all five of those promises, but it impacts the entire community. This particular administration set this up. The president said he was going to develop promised neighborhoods, and it was a competition, and we applied for a promised grant to study it and then to implement it, and we won one of those grants. In this community, it starts with early childhood education, Educare, which has 18 sites around the country, I think, came in and built the most beautiful state-of-the-art early childhood care facility that you've ever seen. It goes on, we brought in a health van from Children's Hospital to provide for the health and needs of the children, a dental van to take care of their dental needs, and then another nonprofit built a freestanding clinic for the entire community. There was a builder who said to me when we were starting this, I know what you want to do and I'll be at your meeting on Monday. He has been active in that community, refurbishing low-income housing and building new affordable housing. He built a high-rise senior citizens building, which is right across the street from Educare. And those older people impact the lives of these young people. It is putting all of these things, all of these assets in one community. There's an elementary school, and then there are two charter schools, a middle school and a charter high school. And we bring in people who give scholarships to children. Experience Corps goes in and works as tutors in the schools and mentoring children. So you're putting all five of those things in there. And we think that that is what makes success. And if we can replicate this in communities, then I think that you will see a difference because you're impacting all of those things. We're talking about the health of children. At America's Promise, we have a policy arm that cannot lobby, but they put the issues of children before the Congress and worked awfully hard on CHIP. And so as we identify what children's needs are, they can go and present what it is and what they need to be addressing.
Mona, I saw you nodding on this.
Absolutely. So you're very much describing community schools model. Mm-hmm. So in the 1930s, actually, Flint started the community schools model, and they called it a lighthouse, where people came not just for school programming, but healthcare and education, and it was like this neighborhood hub. Mm-hmm. And that's something that we're rebuilding. And I love what you said about early education, because the emphasis, as much as possible, based on what we learn from brain development, is zero to five,
right,
building those Educare centers and those high quality child care and preschools, because the more we invest then, the less we have to invest later.
All of these things cost the community nothing. Yeah. All of these services are free.
How are they free?
Educare is funded by the Educare Foundation, and so child care is free from 6 weeks old to 5 years old. There is no charge for parents. When it was first being built, people in the neighborhood said, "What is that for? Nobody can go there but rich people." And we said, "It's yours and it's free." And that is the case with most of the programs that are there. They cost the people who use them nothing.
And that creates economic stability.
Yes.
When people move into those neighborhoods, you improve your tax base.
Yes.
And there's more stability.
Yes. And this addresses the needs of parents in the community, too. The needs of the entire community are addressed. And that's what we have to think about when we're trying to make a difference in places.
Jerry?
Well, I was just going to say I like where this conversation has gone, because while I started, and I meant it, the idea of moving from high poverty to low poverty areas, not everybody's going to be able to do that.
No.
And in fact, there's always been a part of that idea that I have a slight reservation about, which is an adverse selection problem, which is the idea that the people most likely to move to have the initiative or access the policies to move out may be the ones who are have some sort of advantages over the people who are getting left behind. And so the idea, we simply cannot consign kids who aren't able to access lower poverty areas through their parents' mobility to the kind of deep poverty that they suffer in those communities. So this is a really good idea. I want to say a word or two about quality preschool for at least 3 and 4 year olds, and probably and probably be smart to do better given some of the comments Bernard made earlier about a brain functioning. If you, this to me is probably the biggest policy mistake that we make in this country year after year after year. If you look at every other advanced economy, they figured this out a long time ago. And this is something that, so I'm an economist, and I interact with economists from across the political spectrum, and we find a ton to disagree about. This ain't one of those things. It is widely recognized by economists and policymakers who are not operating from a strictly ideological base that the bang for the buck of this kind of investment is something in the neighborhood. I mean, there's different numbers, but you invest a dollar now and you get something like $7 to $14 later in life through all kinds of both upside occurrences that you help to stimulate. So better employment, better health, those kinds of things, and downside ones that you the probability goes down for those. So incarceration. Things like that, dependency on public programs. So that if you kind of want to ask yourself, what is something that we're failing to do every year whose damage is compounding year by year, both on kids as they go forward and our fiscal future, that's certainly a top candidate.
Mm-hmm. Well, one of the health issues that this administration focused on a lot, Michelle Obama focused on a lot, was nutrition and fitness. And if you look at the data on obesity, there's been some movement on if you pick and choose, you'll find a couple numbers that look a little better, but not wholesale improvement. But there also hasn't been that much improvement in terms of the other side, in terms of hunger. Mm-hmm. With one in five children lacking access to adequate nutrition, facing food insecurity. It's hard to believe that in 2016 we're still talking about hunger in America. And what would you recommend to the next administration as a way of tackling this problem? And you know, your point earlier, Alma, that the Educare doesn't cost anything. Why, when it comes to children's health, does the bar have to be that it doesn't cost us anything? Yeah. When it comes to nutrition, and a lot of the things that we're
talking
about,
nothing doesn't cost anything.
There's a cost somewhere. It may not be borne by that community,
but it's born somewhere.
And,
yeah.
And why is it wrong to say we're going to spend money on children? So when it comes to nutrition, what would be the recommendation so that one in five children no longer have that issue of food insecurity?
Well, focusing again on this one community, you're able to address that. Martha's Table goes in on the weekends with groceries for families for the entire week coming forward, addressing that need. In that community, there is no supermarket. The only place to shop is a glorified 7-Eleven.
Mm. Why is there no supermarket?
We can't get one to come there.
Mm. Food, the so-called food desert.
It is definitely a food desert, and they tell us you don't have enough people when we approach supermarkets. There are not enough people in the community. Well, these people have to shop somewhere, and now it takes them an hour or so to get someplace to buy groceries. And so we've tried to work with other nonprofits like Mother's Table to bring food in to the community and make it available for families.
Other ideas?
Well, I just want to start by saying what we are already doing to fight food insecurity. The government is doing a lot. It's not doing enough. But I want to make the point that food stamps or SNAP make a big difference in food insecurity, food and hunger, and actually decrease poverty and have been shown to have long-range impacts on health, on graduation from high school, on a variety of things for kids.
Obesity.
So, obesity. And obesity, decrease obesity.
Because yep. what do they buy at the 7-Eleven?
Yeah. Giving food reduce obesity?
Because, we're not quite sure, but our theory about that is that kids who are hungry all the time and who are poor, when they get access to food, generally get access to high-calorie, calorie-dense food and eat a lot of it.
Exactly.
And then they're hungry again. So they're actually connected, even though they seem to be sort of unconnected. But they are very connected. Mm-hmm. And so having adequate food regularly really does decrease obesity. Mm-hmm. But it's not only food stamps. It's the WIC program for women and children. It's school lunches and breakfasts and summer feeding. I think you brought this up, summer feeding programs. Mm-hmm. What happens to poor kids in the summer is that they lose their school lunches.
And we know
that for many of them, two-thirds of their calories they get at school.
That's right.
So those are the things we can do. The problem, why are still kids hungry? I think because we're not doing enough. We're in the process now of trying to get Congress to pass a reauthorization of school lunches, of WIC programs, and there's just not enough money in that program to really adequately provide all that kids need.
Jared, what do you say to critics who say programs like this build dependency?
I just tell them they're wrong.
Good answer.
So Bernard made an important point that helps underscore my glib answer, which is, I mentioned this longitudinal research. So now that we've got decades of data on food stamp and now SNAP eligibility, we've been able to track kids who were in communities that got SNAP before other communities. So again, a natural experiment. And that's where you get the results that Bernard cited on higher, better education outcomes, employment outcomes, health outcomes, less obesity. And I know of no evidence that suggests that if you provide someone with nutritional support, anything other nothing else happens except they get them and their kids get better nutritional support. That's not really a problem. I mean, there are some arguments about dependency from the perspective of if you earn a higher margin, if you earn quote too much money, you start losing your benefits, you lose your food stamp benefits. And so that's what economists think of as a high marginal tax rate, because you earn an extra dollar, you actually get less back when you consider what you lose in food stamps. And what we find is that the response of low-income people to those kinds of alleged work disincentives are not zero, but they're minuscule, such that the incentives to work are actually quite strong. Family income goes up when these folks work, and so if gainful employment is available, which is, by the way, another big problem, they will take advantage of it. So I just wanted to say one other piece of this. Here's what I would do to help in the food insecurity space. Again, it's not a direct measure, but it's an important indirect. I'd raise the minimum wage. And this is something that you talk about the transition. This is something that one of the candidates has on her agenda. So.
Can I add to that comment? So getting to the economic position of the family who's on food stamps, in this country, since welfare reform has basically gotten rid of welfare, cash benefits, very few people are getting very little. Mm-hmm. So that the base of a family who's getting food stamps is often, they have no other cash but the food stamps. That's a big problem. So getting them more cash, either by getting them work and raising the amount of money that they can make it work, or having some other way to support that family, also will help the nutrition. Because right now, there are 1.5 million kids living on less than $2 a day in this country, which is hard to believe, but it's true. And those families basically have no cash. And often, the only way they can pay their rent is to use their food stamps.
I'm going to stop after this. I just want to add one number to this.
Yeah, okay.
Because I happen to have this paper with me that we recently published. So for a single mom with two kids who's working half-time at the current minimum wage of $7.25, which is egregiously low, their annual income is about $16,800, so $16,800. If this single mom then works full-time, she does lose some food stamps, their income goes up by $9,000 to about $26,000, actually almost $10,000 to about $26,000. So what she gains in salary, earned income tax credit, child tax credit, far surpasses anything she loses in food stamps, which is why the work incentive points in exactly that direction.
I want to switch topics, see if he's got paper on this. One of the topics in the blueprint is something that's been very hard to talk about in America, and that's gun violence. We are barraged by stories about gun violence every day, whether it's the streets of Chicago or you don't have it, it's everywhere. Mm-hmm. And this is something that clearly has an impact on children through what they see, and on children in the cities through shortened life expectancy and everything that comes with gun violence. What is it that the next administration can do that the current administration and previous administrations have been unable to do? And I see everyone shaking their heads with this look of despair. Mm-hmm. Is this an issue that is just a non-starter in our current political climate?
I'll start by saying the following story, basically. We know about Sandy Hook in Connecticut, and I was convinced that after first and second graders and their teachers were murdered, that we as a country would do something about gun violence. I actually couldn't imagine that we were a society that would not respond to that. So I was hopeful that even some minimal things that we would recommend get done would at least get done. And those minimal things, and they're minimal, are, you know, no loopholes and gun shows and adequate background checks and no assault weapons. And in this situation, some states don't even want to allow pediatricians to counsel parents about gun violence.
Yeah.
And there's no money allowed for doing research to understand how we can improve the situation. So that would be my first, not that that's going to cure this, but it seems that should be obvious that we should be doing that. And the problem is going to be, of course, it's not just the president that has to do that. It has to be Congress that has to do that. So the AAP, we've begun rediscussing this because of the continued violence. We felt we can't just give up. We have to bring the best minds together, and we're planning to develop a summit to try to bring people together to understand where are there any levers. But I don't have too many levers to offer you today.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, it's heartbreaking. And
it is.
Before, you know, the Flint water crisis, actually we had kids with high lead levels because of retained bullets.
Mm-hmm.
It was that bad. And it's heartbreaking. The trauma is not only in the victim and the family, it is in the loss of the incarcerated parent. It is in a community-wide trauma that we see every day in our inner cities. And our children, they lack hope, and they lack that vision of a future because it's so rampant. And we need to be louder on this issue, and we need to develop allies on this issue. But there are common sense interventions that need to be passed, and it is embarrassing as a nation that we have not been able to move forward on this.
I don't know what we do about the gun culture in this country, because it just seems to permeate everything. In my upper income community, someone moved in and opened a gun store. Everyone in the community was astounded, but you can't do anything about it. He hasn't broken any laws. And to make this even worse, there's a school in the backyard of this gun store. So what do you do? I don't know. I think we have to, as a nation, have a collective conversation about this and a strength of will to stop things like this. Don't know how it happens, but we need to start talking about it.
I'm shortly going to turn to you all for questions. I could be asking questions all day. I love asking questions, but I will shortly come to all of you. Before I do, you know, one question just to try and get us in a little more hopeful bent. The setup is not hopeful. Congress is as partisan as it has ever been. But when you think about children's health, are there any issues that you see that you think both sides of the aisle could come together and say, in the way that they did with CHIP, is there anything that you think that would improve children's health where you think Congress would be willing to take some action?
Well, last year, in addition to reauthorizing CHIP, at the end of the year, they actually made permanent the improvements in earned income tax credit and child tax credit that were put into place during the recession and were about to expire. And actually, we were very concerned. Everybody was very concerned that that would not happen. And it did happen. So I think there is some hope that in some areas we can get agreement to move forward. I do think, even though right now reauthorization of the food programs is sort of in limbo, I do think that we will eventually come to a bipartisan agreement to make that happen. So I think there are some areas where we can do that. I know that tomorrow we're sending a lot of pediatricians up to the Hill to meet with their Congress people. And they meet with Republicans, they meet with Democrats, and they try to work with everybody. And our attitude is we sometimes really succeed with both parties. So that I think we have to, I think we have to focus on that children's needs come first. And sometimes you can really reach anybody when you focus on that.
Sure. You know, you asked a question earlier about food stamp dependency. And I think that that's kind of the alleyway by which I would think of your question. And it's not so much can we get a Congress that's so gridlocked and dysfunctional to do some of the kinds of things we've been talking about today, although those are absolutely great aspirations. I mean, one of the answers is we may need a pretty different type of a Congress, and that's a longer-term endeavor. But there is also a matter of kind of do no harm. So there are ideas reduce the effectiveness of anti-poverty programs. Mm-hmm. And some of those ideas are based on this notion that there's too much dependency on programs, even though the evidence, as I suggested, and I gave you a table just based on facts of the case on how incomes change as earnings go up, push in exactly the opposite direction. I mean, interestingly, and I think this is largely a good thing, although we've left some significant groups behind, anti-poverty policy has gotten more conditioned on work over time. That's partly the increase in the earned income credit, the child tax credit, some of the improvements that Bernard just mentioned. And so, at least from a sense of argumentation, that kind of helps our case and pushes back on this notion of dependency. I think where you'll see some trouble trying to be made is in trying to add work requirements to programs that don't currently have them, and they don't need them. Again, the evidence is very strong, in no small part because a family with kids can't function simply on the safety net alone. Families will work when gainful employment appears. And the assumption that conservatives make is that too many conservatives make is that what's standing between a poor parent and the job is simply that she doesn't want the job, as opposed to the decent job isn't there. And so I think there is some traction that folks like us can have on a rear guard battle to make a lot of advances in these areas, but to block things that would undermine programs that are already helping kids.
I want to turn to you all now, and are you collecting questions from the internet? So we'll do internet questions as well. The microphones will come around. Please introduce yourself, say what organization you represent, and please keep your question short rather than long. Let's start up here in the front. And the mic's back there. We'll come to you second. Thank you.
Hi. My name's Rich Bland. I work for Save the Children. And I want to thank AAP in particular. We tend to work together on emergency response policy and programs and also on health. We've also formed a C4. Because we were so tired in promoting early childhood education, all politicians say they are in favor, but they don't actually back it up. So my question to you is advice on usually the argument and campaign stall out on two grounds, so you can choose. One is the pay for. So how are you going to pay for it? It always comes back at the state or local level. And so we're trying to put a menu together of things like user fees or a ballot initiative, go around the legislature kind of thing. States that have done it well. The other one, which I'm more intrigued by, and AAP could be really helpful on, and that is that early childhood education declines over time, or that the Head Start study in Tennessee in particular, it's a wasted investment. You say there's this ROI. We tend to, the single best answer I've heard to that is it's not a vaccination, it's not an inoculation, to use your own terminology, that you have to support kids when they get to school. But how, other than more research longitudinally showing the benefits. How do we combat that argument?
So your question is that the return on investment in early education isn't as strong as people are saying?
Yeah,
it tends to wear off.
Third grade, the benefits, like third grade reading
in particular. I mean, I can speak to that. I mean, they're really, at least to me, and maybe I'm just too dyed in the research kind of person, but there is no answer then other than research that examines precisely that question. And I'm not sure you know about, there was recently a very nice review of the full spate of work on this question that was done by scholars at Berkeley University, and it's the Labor and Something Center, I can't remember. Really very good review of precisely these longitudinal, I mean, the reason why this has opened up a bit is because we now have enough data to show some sleeper effects from the Head Start programs that belie the idea that the benefits all fade by a long shot. Look, on the pay for, the only thing I'll say is I've argued that
what is the pay for?
Oh, what does that mean?
Yeah,
That's where are you going to get the resources to pay for the program? If the program costs X billion over a year, you either have to raise X billion or add that to the budget deficit. So I've liked this idea of a financial transaction tax, a very small tax on financial transactions. Hillary Clinton has a sort of version of that in her platform, obviously a very heavy political lift. Bernie Sanders had one. I like it because it takes this problem of concentrated income inequality and deals with one of the impacts of concentrated income inequality, which is immobility among poor kids. So it seems like a nice connection, but I grant you that, like any other pay for, it's a heavy lift.
Can I just add on the early education piece and the return on investment? You can pick a study. There's a bazillion studies out there, and I don't think this is an issue where we need more research. Often that's an answer. We need more research. The Perry Preschool Project's been tracking kids for 40 years and shows this incredible return on investment from half-day preschool. So I think I was actually I'm hopeful that is one of the issues where I do see bipartisan support, and I'm hopeful that something may pass in the next administration. But I think the evidence is there. It is solid. It just needs to be funded by a pay-for.
So question here, and then we'll move over to this side.
Good afternoon. I'm Jerry Paulson. I'm a pediatrician. I'm representing no one particular today. What do you all think that the next administration should do about climate change, given the impact that we expect that to have on the future of children?
Is that an issue that the child health community is taking on and should take on?
Yes. In fact, we have a policy on climate change, and we're very concerned about it in child health because kids are going to be the most victimized by climate change over time. I think they need to be I think this administration has tried to do something about climate change. I don't know if you agree, Jerry.
I do.
I know him. So. I think we need to keep the pressure on to do more, even if it's unpopular. But I do think that there has been some movement through this administration, at least to keep up the level of movement that has occurred here.
I want to come here and take a question from the community writ large that are watching us on one of those sites. Jamie?
Yes, this question comes from Dr. Doug Waite, a medical director out of New York. Can we advocate for the first White House conference on children since 1970?
It's been that long.
Apparently, yeah, so.
It's an interesting question because when I was running for AAP president, that was one of my platform issues, which is we should push for a White House conference. And it gets in many ways
it gets to what you were saying.
So I do believe it, but I do think we need to understand what the point of that White House conference is.
It should be.
Because I think a White House conference which brings people together says a lot of nice things and then sits on a shelf is not very useful.
No.
So I think your idea or a real White House conference, but it then has to come with some guarantee that this is going to become a major agenda item for this administration.
I would
push it for that.
What would you want to see the outcome of that kind of conference be?
I think exactly the things we've been talking about.
Pediatric ombudsman, a person whose voice is in all decision making.
Right. Have a, you know, have a department of children and families. But also, I think specifically push and focus heavily on early childhood, on education, on food security, on housing. We haven't even touched the issue of housing for families in this country. When I first became involved in the AP in the mid-1980s, the reason I got involved was New York had an, what I thought was an epidemic of family homelessness that hadn't existed before. And that's how I became involved in the AP and in advocacy. There were 5,000, there were 10,000 children and 5,000 families homeless. Now there are 22,000 children and 11,000 families homeless. And so, and we can do something about family homelessness. And it's it has a major impact on children's lives and on the stress in the family. And it's just not impossible.
A quick detail that I know Bernard and everybody knows is that there is an administration for children and families within HHS, and there is a lot going on there. I recently heard Mark Greenberg, who's the assistant, acting assistant secretary there, talk about areas of homeless, homelessness, kids, child homelessness, sex trafficking, lots of
child
the
child
care, poverty support. So, so it, obviously that could be elevated and done more, but that exists.
Question here, two questions here. Gentleman on the aisle, and then the woman behind him.
Hi, I'm Jason Turk. I'm a pediatrician from Texas. My question really has to do with meta-strategy and communication, because it's been stated a number of times that our lack of progress probably isn't related to a lack of data and evidence. So how do you combat, from a communication point of view, statements and beliefs and notions that are unencumbered by good evidence, but nevertheless still drive the narrative?
Oh, no.
I'll start. Well, evidence doesn't always, people don't know what evidence is frequently. But I do think there are some key messages. And the question is really how to take those key messages and spread them in an effective way. And I think the key messages are poverty is bad for children's health. It has long-term effects, and it costs society. That however there are programs that work. I think one of the myths that people in this country have is that the war on poverty failed, all our programs have failed, there isn't anything we can do. And that's not true. Many of our programs have been, as you we've sort of discussed, have been very effective. They just need to be ramped up. And so I think getting people to understand that actually the programs work, that most poor people are actually working. They're not sitting home waiting to collect some check. They want to work. In fact, they have no option but to work. So I think those are two key things. It's bad for children's health. It makes them sick adults, and it costs society. And there are things we are doing that help and we could do that would really make it better.
I think in terms of communication as well, I think as pediatricians, we bring great stories of our patients and the children that we care for. And when I'm meeting with a legislator or the media and I share a story of the two-year-old I just saw in clinic who's been drinking this water for 2 years, I think that has incredible impact and power. So we have that ability, unlike other professionals, to use those incredible stories.
I would echo that. The data is important. To support and be factual, but the story that embodies that data is something people remember. So, question behind you.
Good afternoon. I'm Laura Searcy. I'm president of the National Association of Pediatric Nurse Practitioners. And one issue that we're grappling with that seems to cross economic lines and cross socioeconomic status is the issue of addiction and substance abuse. We're seeing an epidemic of drug-exposed infants. We're seeing an opioid prescription epidemic and a heroin epidemic. We're seeing 1 in 5 children that are diagnosable with a mental health illness, and all those situations are connected. Addiction has now become the most costly chronic disease in America. So how can we focus on preventing all these harms that either affect or start in childhood and adolescence?
Is this one of those issues where bipartisan support could be found?
I think so. First of all, it, you know, it crosses ethnic and racial lines, and it to some degree it crosses socioeconomic mm-hmm. lines. Not as much as one might think. It's still primarily affecting more poorer people rather than wealthier people. But I think that it does cross a broad spectrum of Americans across the country. So I do think that there is at least a willingness to want to do something about this.
So, first of all, with all these pediatricians here, who's taking care of the children? That's what I like. But I just want to say... Okay. Thank you. So there's 60,000 of you, so I guess I don't have to worry
about
that.
You're okay. The kids are okay.
I just want to say a quick word about the budget. I know that sounds kind of boring, but it actually is responsive to your question and everything else we're talking about here. So let's say there's bipartisan support for this. And I was thinking about some of the initiatives that Paul Ryan has introduced because he definitely articulates interest in anti-poverty ideas, particularly as they affect kids, and in many of the spaces that we've been talking about would resonate with conversations I've heard from them. Well, when you then look at the budget that these folks are putting forth, they very deeply cut taxes for wealthy people. 76% of the tax cuts of the House budget benefit the top 1%. They flow to the top 1%. And the cost of these tax cuts take $4 trillion out of the budget over 10 years. In fact, after 10 years, 99% of the benefits go to the top 1%. So this certainly exacerbates the inequality problem. It very much guts the revenues that we need to do this work. 62% of the spending cuts of this budget comes from low-income programs. So it is very, very important not simply to talk about the bipartisan will to address a problem like the one you mentioned, which clearly does cut across lines. Party lines, but also to be very, I think, rigorous and sort of eye-shady about the actual numbers that people are writing down.
Very good. I don't want to ignore the people closer, people in the back, so way back on the left and then over on this side, and then we'll come back to the front.
I'm Ellen Issenbaum. I'm a colleague of Jared's at the Center on Budget and Policy Priorities. I just want to start by thanking the Academy for the incredible report and particularly thanking you for giving us the opportunity to review it and share input. We're just beyond thrilled that you have broadened this definition and brought awareness. I just want to pick up on two points that you have just made. One is, I think this point that you made, Dr. Dreyer, about the cost of poverty is not something that is well understood or recognized as a really legitimate point. We're having a big discussion right now about the need to invest in our infrastructure, about the cost of not investing in our infrastructure. And while everybody in town is busy redefining themselves as infrastructure, we're all going to get to that bill, there are very important ways, I think, to use that as an analogy. And I would really urge the Academy to do much more in really trying to explain what those costs are, the physical, mental, and the economic mm-hmm. costs. The other thing is, on your point about success and the point about doing this in stories, I think the reason the $2 a day book caught on fire, and I think the reason Matt Desmond's somewhat larger book on Evicted caught on fire, is because they told those, partly with data, but very much around stories. And to the degree that you can empower all of us with the stories about how those investments pay off, I think that makes for a much more impactful approach. So I am very eager to really learn more, as you all are able to do, about what are the real costs when we fail to invest in those kids and the brain development. One thing that we're particularly bringing some focus to, not an issue well known, is the EITC for families with kids is great. EITC with kid credit. The child tax credit for families with kids is obviously very important. Those improvements, by the way, reduce poverty more than any other legislation outside the ACA in 20 years. But for the child tax credit, if you have a mom that works full-time year-round, minimum wage, two kids, she doesn't get close to the maximum of $1,000. And so the child tax credit for the poorest families is quite small, just because of the way it's structured.
I'm going to cut you off there and Benard, just ask you to very briefly, what is the health impact of poverty, just so we're on the same page there?
Sure. So we know I like to think about impacts on health and well-being. So impacts on health, we know, increased infant mortality, increased low birth weight with all the problems that those go with, increase severity and frequency of chronic diseases, increase unintentional accidents and mortality from those accidents, increased obesity, and actually, we now know, increased adult health bad outcomes. So it goes well into adulthood. But I think the impacts on child well-being are equally or perhaps even more important, and that is toxic stress and impact on early brain and child development, poor academic outcomes, what some people call trajectory-altering events, which is increased teen pregnancy, increased drug use, and increased criminal behavior. And all of that leads to intergenerational poverty, and really costs our country a lot of money. It's estimated that child poverty costs our country $500 billion a year, and primarily that comes from lack of productivity, increased health costs, and the cost of incarceration and the criminal justice system.
Question here in the aisle.
Hi, I'm Jackie Noyes, and I'm an honorary pediatrician. That's as close as I can get to that. I think we should look at some positive things that happened in other countries. Back in the 70s, Sweden gave every child the right to vote. Mm-hmm. And the parents held the proxy of those votes until the children were 18. Now, can you imagine politicians at this national level and the state level now going to court, parents who now have votes of 10 and 12, whatever it is, or 4 or 3. But it gives us more power faster out there that we talk about. You talk about the gun problem that we're trying to do something about that first question of ask. But if all parents had voted with their children's votes behind them, we would have beaten the NRA on that. So I think we have to look at ways to get more power because our agenda is huge.
Thank you.
And we have a lot to do. And what you put on first is really hard because everything's, 5, 6, 7, priorities out there. But it's a thought. I don't know what happened in Sweden after that, but back in the 70s, they did it. And I thought it was
those kids became adults.
Thanks for bringing that up, because it is a question I want to ask before we run out of time. I see everyone wearing Vote Kids buttons. But when you look at what politicians respond to, it really isn't children's issues. Children don't vote. So how do you take that concept of Vote Kids and turn it into something meaningful where the issues that are important for children become something that politicians are willing to address? Alma?
Well, that's what we try to address through First Focus in putting issues before the Congress. We don't have a vote, we can't lobby, but we can say this is what we need to do. And we encourage communities that we work with to do the same thing, constantly talk about what it is you need to the people who need your votes.
Jared?
The kinds of ideas we're talking about today, all of which, as I recall, have very substantive evidentiary backup. Are the kinds of things that a lot of people don't go and vote for because they just think they don't work. We talked earlier about messaging, and you asked a good question about that. I think someone else on the panel said the same thing. If you just believe that government is a dysfunctional mess, you'll sit out an election. And there is very much a dynamic that goes on in Washington politics that is extremely destructive, and one I've never quite seen this in decades of doing this, which is politicians essentially saying to their constituents, Washington's broken, send me to Washington, I'll make sure it stays that way.
Yeah, exactly.
And that kind of dysfunctionality is really a virus in the system, and it's fed by the notion that nothing works. Well, we've got a lot of great evidence about not just the things that work, but they work for kids, and their benefits were downed over generations. So part of the answer to your question is to really tell the story about the effectiveness of these programs better.
One thing I think we need to think about, we talk about it on a national level. We need to bring it down to a community level. For example, in upcoming elections, we're starting to get information about things to vote for in our county. We need to pay attention to that. There's a call now for people to vote for meal tax. What is that going to pay for? It is going to increase funds for schools, which is what they need. It will pay for arts programs in schools, which have been put out of the budgets because we have to address other things. So at a local level and in our own communities, we need to look at what the laws are that we can affect with our vote.
I want to grab a question here. We're running close to time, right? So a question down here.
My name is Woody Kessel, and in part, I'm equally a pediatrician. But I'm here representing a little girl whose name is Avielle Richmond, and she lost her life at Sandy Hook. And Richard, thanks for raising this issue. And I think I want to connect some of these things, and thank you to the Academy for the leadership in this space and any number of people. But I think one of the ways we're trying to take this problem on is the same way, Mona, you've taken on what we thought was not a problem anymore, lead poisoning. Mm-hmm. But looking back, Rich, at some of the successes in public health, whether it's been cigarette smoking, where there was a corporate entity that suppressed evidence and worked to not have anti-smoking, we were successful with a public health approach. We were successful with a public health approach with car safety seats and seat belts. And equally, and Mona, I think, has been successful in the focus on lead poisoning. And we are, as part of the Avielle Foundation, with colleagues, and including the Academy, trying to apply a public health approach, trying to depoliticize this, but look at these opportunities to apply what we've learned from lessons in the past, and particularly focused on each community, where communities can make their decisions with collaborative partners, with the pediatrician in the office and the officer on the street. But I think, Rich, you will attest to the value of the public health approach in solving some of these kinds of problems. And hopefully that's going to provide some optimism for moving some things forward.
Mona, I want to ask you the last question before I turn it back over to Karen. Lots of pediatricians in the office, in the audience, and there's a growing understanding that so much of children's health isn't what takes place when you're seeing the patient in your practice. It's what's going on in the community. But for many, there's a sense that there's just a paralysis, that it's impossible to impact on what's taking place outside of your office. Mm-hmm. What do you say to those people who see these problems and think, I sure hope someone tackles that?
Yeah, so if we go about our day-to-day as pediatricians taking care of one patient after the other patient, well child, ear infection, what have you, you know, it's great and it's rewarding and I love that. And, you know, the continuity you established is just incredible and the rapport with the families and that trust. But we need to step out of our boxes. The job description of a pediatrician is an advocate because our children cannot vote and they cannot tell you, I need better gun control and I better need better immunizations and this and that. We must use our very, very, very surprisingly credible voices in our communities. Our communities need us. They've been wanting to hear from us and we have become almost automatons in our daily work. So use your voices. You will be surprised on the reaction. And I think far too often we do get jaded. And through medical training, through medical school residency, you know, as an attending, we beat that altruism out of our docs. And I think it also speaks to the need to change medical education and to put in more advocacy and public health training into it. But this is our job. And I am so proud to be a pediatrician, to be part of this panel, and to be part of an organization of professionals that recognizes this is our job too.
So what a perfect way, right, to have end the conversation, but it is not an end. I've told everybody today, the blueprint is really just a knock on the door. This is what kind of gets you in, and then it's the conversations. It's distilling what we talked about today. It's thinking about individual patient stories that we can tell, and it's being that trusted partner with families and children to help them have the best health they can have. So I want to say thank you to all of our panelists. A particular thank you to Alma, who held her own with many pediatricians.
And
another thank you to Jared, who I think might become an, I mean, but Alma's been holding her own in the children's world for a long time. Jared, who might now be an honorary FAAP, because I loved the, what do you say when they say that? And he said, I just tell them they're wrong. And I thought, well, they're, you know, that is as cut and dry as you can get it. And not a normal inside the Beltway comment. So thank you. Thank you for each of you for your honesty and for and Rich for being what an incredible moderator and defender of children and a true colleague and friend. Thank you to all the organizations who have endorsed the blueprint and helped develop it. It took a village, and it was a village that cares about children. The webcast is going to be archived and available within a week. And the blueprint you can find online at aap.org/blueprint. And I encourage all of you, even if you don't want to read through all of it, read the first few pages, because it's really a good way to be inspired about what we've done if you weren't already by the incredible conversation we had here. We are going to close this conversation by showing you a video that was created by the AAP to encourage pediatricians to participate in the electoral process, to encourage their families and their employees to encourage in that process, and as Mona said so well, your community to vote for kids. So with that, we'll show the video.
A lot is at stake for children in this election, and children can't vote.
But I can.
I'm a pediatrician.
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 I care for children.
I also advocate for them.
Right now in this country, 1 in 5 children lives in poverty.
7 children and teens die from gun violence every day.
1 in 5 children live in households where food is scarce.
1 in 5 children suffers from a mental health disorder.
From our clinics to our capital,
we have a message for our elected leaders.
America's children need to be
prioritized, protected,
nurtured, supported,
invested in,
believed in,
cared for.
We must put children at the top of our national agenda.
Invest in programs that help children and their families live healthier lives.
Pass laws that lift families out of poverty
and make our communities safer.
Pediatricians do a lot to care for children,
but we need your help.
If you're old enough to vote,
vote for leaders and legislation that prioritize children.
Casting a vote is a small act that can make a big difference.
So vote this election day.
And when you do vote, vote kids.
Vote kids.
Vote kids.
Because kids can't vote, but we can. And so can you.
Great. Hey.
So remember, every politician was once a child, and each one of you was once a child. Yeah. So that's what it's all about. Thank you, everyone.